I'm Jackie. I'm really happy to be here and really honored. And I'm wondering if we might start off together, if you're willing and if you feel safe, by closing our eyes together. For me, this feels important to just begin with a bit of gratitude. And please take a moment to root yourselves in gratitude for all the amazing people who have brought us together. Not only those we see, but all the unseen people who keep these institutions afloat, alive, moving. It feels important to take a moment to acknowledge our relative privilege and hold space for the tens of thousands of children who are being separated from their families right now. And to acknowledge the legacy in the colonized United States to separate children from families as a form of oppression and control. And please take a moment to reflect on the amazing collective outrage and resistance that is forming at this very moment. And take a moment to please say thank you for all the tiny miracles that had to happen for us to be together, to be able to have these kinds of conversations and to change things. I want to talk about the work of bringing the carceral institution into the cultural institution. You guys can open your eyes now. It's safe. I put makeup on, so we're all good. And it's always important that I begin with my elders, Herman Wallace, Albert Woodfox, Robert King, three Black Panthers political prisoners who spent decades in solitary confinement in the state of Louisiana, four decades in a 6-foot by 9-foot cell. And all of my personal and political orientation comes from their tutelage, their patience, their love, and their trust. When you get to be my age and you're given 7 minutes to talk about the breadth of your work, it's a little bit intimidating, so I'm just going to focus on two projects. The first is a collaboration with this man. That's Herman. Herman spent 41 years in solitary confinement in the state of Louisiana. It's 41 years in a 6-foot by 9-foot cell, a minimum of 23 hours a day for a crime he couldn't have possibly committed. And I had the great honor to collaborate with Herman Wallace for 12 years, designing his dream home. And I will say that my privilege, my ability to talk about carceral institutions and cultural institutions like this is gilded and guided by his ability to love his oppressors and his ability to believe that another world is possible. This is a CAD drawing of Herman's house. The work we produced ended up as an exhibition. It began as just a simple letter exchange between myself and Herman. And then I realized it was a really powerful organizing tool to be able to talk not only about his situation and his circumstances amongst the slurry of really terrible news in the colonized United States, but to be able to also talk about the things that he dreams of in his home. And so I began to organize around his life and legacy through the exhibition called The House That Herman Built. And that exhibition became a book. That book became a movie. That movie won an Emmy. And now, oh God, I can't believe I'm saying this out loud. I'm in the process of purchasing land to build Herman's dream home. Yeah, what the fuck? It's amazing, right? It's really amazing. So the work was facilitated for years and years through written, mostly written letter exchanges between Herman and I. Obviously, visits to the prison. Herman spent most of those 41 years in solitary confinement in a prison called Angola in the state of Louisiana, which is a former slave plantation, which is now a slave plantation or prison, the Louisiana State Penitentiary. What required was a longstanding patience and trust. As you can imagine, when you're corresponding mostly through letters, time is shifted and changes. But as we built this exhibition and recognized its value in the social landscape of the colonized United States, a major part of talking about Herman's life required me to build his reality, to build his cell, and then juxtapose it to his imagination. So I'm going to fly through a couple of these slides. Again, with the framework that this is what it means to literally bring the carceral institution into the cultural institution. This is the Brooklyn Library. This is an exhibition in Quebec. And this is AVAM. So you can see that each one was a little bit different, but maintaining the reality of a 6-foot by 9-foot cage felt really important to me, but also it was really important to give people a sense of hope and possibility. As many of you know, after 41 years of solitary confinement, Herman Wallace was released on October 1st, 2013. His conviction was overturned. He died 3 days later from the complications of liver cancer. And it is a absolute tragedy, but I ask you to also hold space for the miracle that Herman Wallace died free, innocent, in the eyes of the law, and surrounded by those of us who loved him most. When I asked Herman what kind of house does a man who spent decades in solitary confinement dream of, the first thing he said is, "I don't dream about no house. I'm a revolutionary. Like, when I come home, I'm gonna be in the hills of Mexico, you know, fighting with the people, for the people." And I was like, "You're 61, man." Like, he was like, "All right, I'll dream about a house." The first thing he said they wanted in his house, he said, "I can clearly see the gardens. They will be filled with gloxinias, delphiniums, and roses, and I want for guests to be able to walk through gardens all year round." And the second thing he asked for was a pool with a large black panther in the center. Priorities, right? So in the wake of this great loss for myself and for the world, when Herman joined the ancestors, I had to really, you know, this is center of my life for 12 years. And it was a major disorientation, not only when you're in pain, huh, but when you lose someone whose purpose fills your own. And I had to figure out what to do, like what comes next. And so this is where the second project I'll talk about, the Solitary Gardens, comes from. The solitary gardens were really a way for me to continue honoring Herman's legacy and target the cruel and unusual punishment of extreme isolation or solitary confinement. And you can see in this diagram that I've taken that carceral cell, the 6-foot by 9-foot, and transformed it into a garden bed. And those garden beds are real, they exist. Right now we have 9 of them going in the city of New Orleans, in particular a small park within the back of town. And they're co-created by folks serving their sentences in long-term solitary confinement and volunteers on the outside. So these prison cells turn garden beds are actually curated by folks in isolation. And then volunteers on the outside grow the food plants and crystals that they wish to be seen. So in a lot of ways, it becomes a social practice where we're taking the folks that are buried deepest in our systems of punishment control and putting them back into our communities. The garden beds, for all intents and purposes, are portraits of those who we've condemned to cages. Those garden beds are fueled, again, through the written exchange. So we send solitary gardeners templates, as well as like a growing menu, depending on where we are growing the garden bed. So there's different zones in the US or different in North America. And then they choose what they'd like to see in their garden bed. Sometimes they go totally rogue, and it's super beautiful. It's a chance for them to really exercise their imagination, which one of the things that became clear with collaborating with Herman was that was his greatest strength, was his imagination. His ability to transcend the institutional walls was really fueled by his imagination. So you can see here a little bit of the process where we're translating one of those drawings and then growing the food for the solitary gardeners. This is another shot on site in New Orleans. I'm going fast. And maybe what you could see here is we are growing. What I think is one of the most eloquent layers to this project is that I'm actually growing sugarcane, cotton, tobacco, and indigo on site. Those are the largest chattel slave crops. And then grinding them down. And then what we do as a collective, you could say, social practice is combine them with lime, pack them into a form. And so those chattel slave crops become the walls of those prison cells turned garden beds, illustrating the evolution of chattel slavery into mass incarceration. That's the plastic form that we use. So it's kind of like a rammed earth process. It's very labor intensive, and I would argue transformative. It's this process where you're talking about this history and changing it. And one of the things that it was total accident, but I find particularly beautiful, is that the sugarcane remains alive in the walls of these prison cells turned garden beds and is ultimately responsible for breaking them down, which is like the ancestors rising. And for me, this is, again, not planned, but I'm humbled by the process. And it was really important. It's a really important design for the project that we see these prison cells disappear. Because there's a lot of conversations today about this notion of implicit bias, right? That you see things associated with each other, and somewhere in the back of the mind, you believe it. Blackness and criminality, whiteness and power, for example. And so it's my hope that if you see this prison cell disappear, that somewhere in the back of your mind, in your subconscious, you believe that it can happen, and we can exist in a world without them. So I'll finish here. This is the current phase of the project and where and how I originally met Elizabeth. I am retrofitting an ambulance to become a prison abolition vehicle called the Garrison. It's a nod to William Lloyd Garrison, the great abolitionist. And so I spent the summer really retrofitting it so that we can travel the solitary gardens around the country and set them up and host institutions so that these garden beds can be grown in various zones in collaboration with folks all around the country who are in isolation. I intentionally painted the garden the garrison like the universe, the very first slide that you saw there, because I think it's really important that we are reminded to dream beyond what we know, and that we're very small, we're very tiny in all of these multiverses of not only possibility, but of existence. And as we try to figure out how to negotiate a world that is so unfair and so inequitable, it's really important that we reorient ourselves towards our smallness. And we open ourselves to possibilities that we haven't seen yet. And so I'll finish here. Which is a reminder of just that. That's Albert Woodfox. Woodfox spent 44 years in solitary confinement for a crime he couldn't have possibly committed. He's standing in front of the garrison, raising a fist for his comrade, Herman Wallace, and standing there as a reminder to never let the word impossible eclipse your imagination, because I believe and wholeheartedly know that there's so much work for love to do. And thank you very much for your time.